Hi, this is Frank, and welcome back to The Next Realignment. In this episode, we're going to continue the story of America's first party system, and we're going to talk about how the Federalist Party imploded and the first party system came to its end. When Thomas Jefferson was sworn in as president, he came into the Senate chamber and he gave a speech that's gone down in history. And he said the noble sounding words of, "We are all Republicans, we are all Federalists." And it's a statement that's often been taken by people to say, it was a statement of unity, that he was calling the country together. He was saying, yes, we are two different parties. Yes, we have political disagreements. But at the end of the day, we're all Americans, and we're all united, and we're all working together for the good of the country. What he actually meant was something more like this. The Federalist Party, as he saw it, was a malicious cabal. It was a bunch of wicked leaders who had misled the country and had taken the voters who had supported them down to a bad place. And now, finally, they had been defeated. The Republicans had won. And now that they had won, they were going to stomp out the Federalist Party and get rid of it and put it into dust. And when they did, all of America would be united again. We would all come back together, freed of the wickedness of the Federalist cabal, and we would do so under the banner of the Democratic Republican Party and Thomas Jefferson. And he wasn't alone in feeling this way, because the Federalists felt much the same way when they had had power. John Adams, who was the president right before Thomas Jefferson, he had felt exactly the same way, which had led him into one of the most disgraceful moments of American history, the passage of a group of acts we call the Alien and Sedition Acts. Because what had happened was this. It was a moment where tensions with France were high. There was a thought that we might end up in a war with France. And Adams and his government, in fear of that potential war, passed a bunch of laws, some of which were meant to give them the power to deport immigrants from countries friendly with France or French immigrants, but more than that, gave them the power to criminally prosecute anybody who opposed any measure of the United States or who criticized the president. And more than that, Adams then went and used those laws to actually put in prison journalists and political activists associated with the Democratic Republicans for criticizing his government. You think, how could John Adams, one of the founding generation, lover of liberty, how could he possibly do such a thing that from where we stand today, a political party throwing its opponents in jail is horrific? But he did it because, again, he didn't yet see the Democratic Republicans as legitimate political opposition. He didn't see the Democratic Republicans and the Federalists as two rival political parties as we see it today and as a part of the system and a normal feature of political debate. He saw them as illegitimate opposition and disruptive and a threat to the government and the stability of the United States that had to be stomped out and ended. So this is where we were in 1800 when Jefferson takes control of the government. We are now a two-party system. But the founders don't yet even realize it. So, what happened next? Well, Thomas Jefferson, naturally, threw the entire weight of his office, wanting to undo everything the Federalists up to then had done, and particularly anything that had anything to do with Alexander Hamilton. He dedicates the early part of his presidency to identifying and eradicating any piece of Federalism that he could see in the government. He does all kinds of things. He pardons anybody who had been prosecuted under the Alien and Sedition Acts. He tries to cut spending in the government to get rid of the debt that Hamilton had assumed because he thought that debt was corrupting. He tries to shrink the size of the military because Democratic Republicans don't support standing armies. But more than anything else, the most important, he charges his Treasury Secretary, Albert Gallatin. He tells Gallatin to tear into Hamilton's economic programs to find all the corruptions and mistakes that he is sure that he's going to find there. So Gallatin does it. He tears into the program. He comes back to Jefferson And he tells him, to Jefferson's great annoyance, he said, it was the most perfect system ever designed. He said, any change to it would injure it, and that Hamilton had done nothing wrong. And that summed up Jefferson's presidency. Now that he was in power and the Democratic Republicans were in a position to rule, on issue after issue, they looked at Federalist policies and, intending to get rid of them, ultimately came around, flip-flop on the issue, and adopted them. They eventually, after originally reducing the size of the military, over time, Jefferson bolstered it. And then he even got involved in a foreign war against North African pirates. He purchased the Louisiana Territory, which was an amazing thing to do because, one, it cost a ton of money, which was something the Democratic Republicans opposed, that type of federal spending. But more than that, the Democratic Republicans had always asserted that the government didn't have the power to do any such thing. But now, in a position to do it, Jefferson was happy to do it to great applause from his party and the country at large. See, the Hamiltonian economic policies, the Democratic Republicans adopted them all. Federalist and Democratic Republicans continued to rip each other apart. They made the same arguments, the same rhetoric, they had the same ideology, but in practice, they really didn't disagree about anything at all. In practice, the debate was over because the Democratic Republicans had actually adopted all of the Federalist policies and just wrapped it in Democratic Republican ideology. At that point, the only thing that was really left to separate the parties in practice, other than politics, was this issue about Britain over France. And that came to a head during the next presidency of James Madison, Jefferson's close ally, in the War of 1812. James Madison, the new president, wants to continue with Jefferson's policies. And there's now a group they called the War Hawks in Congress, young Democratic Republicans who are hot-headed and they're itching for war, led by a man named Henry Clay, who's going to become important in later American history. And these War Hawks, they're looking around and this is what they see. They see an opportunity to get back at England while it's distracted with France. Britain and France during the Napoleonic Wars had been an on and off state of war for years and years and years. And France had a grand army and controlled the continent. And Britain had a great navy and controlled the seas. And what that meant was neither country could successfully invade and beat the other. The French couldn't get over to Britain to invade, and the British army couldn't beat the French army. So they were locked in a stalemate. And they fought that stalemate for years and years through foreign trade. Both the British and the French wanted to cut off any trade with their rival. And that really stuck it to the United States, because young America, which still needed to trade and import everything, relied on trade with Europe. And what they were finding was that American ships were getting boarded and raided, and there was really nothing that the United States could do about it. Both powers would raid American ships and shut down their trade and embargoing the other, and it was leading to all kinds of tensions and possible wars, but it was really as bad as France was. It was worse with Britain because Britain, in part, kind of enjoyed humiliating its former rebellious colony. But more than that, they were also impressing sailors because the British were in great need of trained sailors. So when they would raid American ships, they would take anyone on board that they believed had been a British citizen or had been born a British citizen, even if they were now Americans. And they weren't really careful about who that was. So they would take Americans off and impress them into the British Navy. And it even got so bad that once, under Jefferson's presidency, they invaded and boarded an American warship of the U.S. Navy and took American Navy sailors off into the British Navy, creating a huge international incident. So the War Hawks saw an opportunity that with Britain distracted, they could declare a quick war, get back revenge for all the humiliations against the power that the Democratic Republicans did not like. They could also maybe capture British territory in Canada and add it to the United States. And they could also stop the British from trying to hinder American expansion west. So they decided to declare war, and Madison went along with it. And it was a disaster. It was a disaster of a war, because it turned out Britain wasn't as distracted as the War Hawks thought. The American invasion of Canada got repulsed. The British Navy shut down American trade, completely cutting off particularly the states in the North and New England that were dependent upon that trade. And worst of all, the British invaded, captured Washington, D.C., chased the government out of town, and burnt the White House. The War of 1812 was naturally pretty unpopular everywhere, but it was really unpopular in New England and in Federalist states. The Federalist base in New England was the ones who were hurt most by the loss of trade. They were also on the border with British Canada, so the government expected that the militias in New England would bear the brunt of the fighting, all to fight a war declared by the other party against the Federalist preferred ally, and every time the Federalists complained about it, the Democratic Republicans banging the war drums would basically accuse them of being unpatriotic traitors. So eventually, the Federalists in New England had had enough, and they declared that they were going to have a convention in Hartford, Connecticut, and they sent delegates. Madison and the government wasn't sure what the Federalists were going to do and what New England was going to do. They were afraid they might secede, and there was rumblings in the newspapers that that might be the result. And they actually readied the army in case New England tried to secede from the Union. But what happened instead was these delegates came together in this convention in Hartford, Connecticut, and they issued a bunch of demands of constitutional reforms to stop something like this from ever happening again. Among other things, they wanted a two-thirds majority in Congress to declare wars. They wanted to limit the president to only one term. They wanted to get rid of the Three-Fifths Compromise that gave more representation to slave states who tended to vote Democratic Republican. And they took this petition and they were going to take it to Washington. But it turned out their timing was very, very unlucky. By the time they got there, a signed peace treaty was already on its way. And that peace treaty restored the status quo. What had also happened was General Andrew Jackson had a great military victory against the British in the Battle of New Orleans. And in that battle, the American people interpreted as a great patriotic victory. So with the war over and the Battle of New Orleans making Andrew Jackson a hero, America got rushed into a new patriotic fervor. This war that had been a disaster was suddenly in a moment transformed to a great triumph that America had stood up to a superpower again, and a lot of people started calling it the Second War for Independence. And with this, the Federalists show up with all of their demands, backed by an implicit threat of secession. And the Federalist brand turned toxic. The Federalists looked like a bunch of secessionists and traitors in the middle of a patriotic fervor. And the Federalist Party, in a moment, collapsed. Because ambitious politicians were looking around and they no longer wanted to be associated with the Federalists, and they started fleeing the party label. Now, the party survived on paper in a weak way for a while after that, but pretty much in a moment, the party died. The Federalist Party, after one political blunder, albeit a big one, but one major political blunder, it was enough to suddenly rip the party apart. I mean, there had been all kinds of political blunders by both parties over time. There always are. Why was this political crisis big enough to rip an entire party apart? And not just a party system. The entire system of two parties that had ruled America since the first days of the Washington administration. Because, as we've discussed, party systems are a debate. They're a great debate over issues. And those issues that had built these parties and had held their coalitions together and had motivated them for decades were now resolved. The American people had over time listened to both sides, listened to the Federalist program, and they'd agreed and they adopted it. They listened to the Democratic Republican complaints and they agreed and put them into power. There was nothing else to debate. There was nothing else to sacrifice or to hold you together as a coalition, as a Democratic Republican or a Federalist. And in that circumstance, the glue that had held the parties together had turned very brittle. All that was left was habit and inertia and careerism and politics and slogans. And with parties that weak that had all of a sudden stood for nothing, all it took was a bit of a crisis to smack into a party. And with that crisis, people fled. There was nothing to hold either party together anymore. other than habit. So all it took was one crisis in the making the brand look bad, and the party fell apart. And once the brand was no longer decent vehicle for habit and politics, it died. And the first party system naturally collapsed. Thanks a lot for watching, and please tune in to the next episode as we take the story to where it goes next. And that is to the era of good feelings, the strange era of no party government that followed the collapse of the first party system and set America up for the beginning of the second party system.